exposure of the subalterns and the Dalits to British education brought an awareness to people like Phule and later on Dr. Ambedkar. Dissemination of their revolutionary thoughts broke the clutches of self-colonization of Dalits and then started the process of decolonization, as it is mentioned above. The process of self-determination culminated into the beginning of decolonization. Sharan Kumar Limbare has rightly captured the reflections of self-colonization and decolonization through his characters. What makes his writing distinct and objective is that he has also beckoned at the emergence of neo-colonization. At this time, the threat is posed by the empowered Dalits, the insiders. The way African writer R. Maha puts the problem of Bintus, Dr. Limbare also gives clarion call against the educated Dalits. Chuachut, written by Sharan Kumar Limbare and translated into Hindi by Nishikant Thakkar, is a short story collection divided into three sections. Stories of upper class people about Dalits and treatment to be given to them. Stories from second section explain the exploitation of Dalits and their miserable condition, as well as their firm denial and response to the situations. Third section delineates some women characters. Some are sufferers and some cause sufferings. The way post-colonial writers insist on rewriting their identity, the short stories from the collection pose a question of their identity. The question of their identity is not only defined by their gender, for the purpose of establishing equality. But the doubts of Dalit activists and the explanation and questions by the upper class activists give rise to paradoxical questions and demand answer from him, and he has no answer. The narrator himself is troubled by the thoughts like how to eradicate inequality, when atrocities will end, when there will be freedom, fraternity and justice. The Dalit youngsters doubt the very intentions of the upper class activists and they demand answers. The narrator records the process of self-determination of the youngsters as, quote unquote, they were very curious. Their questions were not straight. The new generation was very sharp. One of the young boys criticizes the upper class activists that, quote unquote, these women interview the poor, then they publish it and thus earn money. Our sorrow is their capital, on the basis of which they have started their business. We must demand answers from them. Ramesh, another boy, is equally demanding. He interrogates the activists, quote unquote, we will serve our community. Who are these? Who are these people? Why do they come here? Mehboob also lodges his grudge that, quote unquote, these people inquire about us and write their PhD thesis, get the award of Dalit Mitra, their salaries increase and we remain as we were. Nowadays it has become a fashion to speak about poor. But the narrator, being an accommodationist, is of the view that, quote unquote, there should be many such organizations and activists to eradicate the discrimination that has been in practice since 1,000 years. The sizzling anger, doubt and demanding attitude and assertion of the young generation makes the narrator restless, and he proposes a midway, saying that, quote unquote, by hurting the upper classes, the problems of Dalit will increase. Considerate nature is essential. Upper classes. The society has been trapped by rules of religion. On every page of the scriptures, orders of insult and agony are written for Dalits. These fails, times, deny us our manliness, humanity. The story Confidential Report deals with discriminatory treatment to Dalit people at workplace. But the protagonist displays his strength of awareness when he is not allowed to place the photo of Dr. Ambedkar by his superior. He protests, quote unquote, sir, just as Lakshmi and Satyanarayana are your gods, Dr. Ambedkar is our god. Either keep the photograph of Dr. Ambedkar or remove the photograph of Lakshmi and Satyanarayana. Kotwa Savne's case from the story Samadhi exemplifies the completion of decolonization. Past made him helpless. But at the end of the story, Trimukh is shown stepping towards decolonization by contributing a rupee to the fund for making the statue of Dr. Ambedkar. The process of decolonization on the part of the youngsters is not easy or one way. Dalits from different villages are inspired by the revolution of thoughts directed by Dr. Ambedkar, but the silver cloud has a dark line. Narrator of the story Johar, salute, evaluates this paradox. He says, quote unquote, "The inspiration of Dr. Ambedkar's movement reached to localities like Storm. Last year, our village celebrated birth anniversary of Dr. Ambedkar. We rejected him the double standard approach of the upper classes. Some characters realize the change in society and say, quote unquote, the hands with which we pull the dead animals now inaugurate the function. The days are changing. The class is changing." But the writer shows that this change is very expensive and at the cost of their identity. The way the post-colonial writers talk about white mask and African writer Armaha speaks of Bintus in his society, the progressing Dalit characters find themselves the means of neocolonization and being victimized by their own people. The protagonist in the story, Apni Apni Simai, our own boundaries, writes, quote unquote, "I have become strongly aware of my limitations. I'm restless. I have made the movement the means of my luxury." And he asks himself, quote unquote, "Now my language is standard. My pronunciations are like that of Brahmins. My costumes are very decent. Is this a change?" The question by the protagonist makes it clear that decolonization has its own dangers. Either one may be really decolonized or one may go astray in the name of progress and change. This danger is clearly reflected in the feelings of the protagonist of the story, Chua Chut, who wants to cling to his upper class friends and feels disgust for his old father.
The upper caste, what they write on Dalits, that can be considered as Dalit literature. So this is like one upper caste anxiety which tries to define what is Dalit literature. However, the upper caste have the institutions to legitimize, to publish their work and, you know, get it through their Dalit literature. One example is school textbook. The first time I came across any Dalit literature was through my school textbook, and that was by an upper caste writer. It was a story in my, the introduction is whether the upper castes are allowed to, you know, write on Ambedkar and Dalit issues. The same question of authenticity, Ms. Rashi Chandra asked in her blog article on Kafila, which is titled Unowning Archives in General, Ambedkar in Particular. So Arunthi Roy or any other upper caste writer was never stopped. She said, yeah, like, we upper caste, they, like her own experience that, you know, I don't like this articulation because that challenges with what I think it challenges my privilege. So that, and we will we'll discuss about it more later in this paper. I'll come back to this Navyana and version of Annihilation of Caste which we are discussing here. So this came in 2014, last year, and as you know, it was Annihilation of Caste was an undelivered speech which Ambedkar had to self-publish. So the new critical annotated version of Annihilation of Caste, it carried an introduction by Arunthi Roy titled The Doctor and the Saint, and there were annotations by S. Anand. There have been controversies around that, and you know, when these critics from which were on published on social media and blog, those were branded as misogynistic and xenophobic. So I when I tried to, you know, find question of caste, they would be often you know, termed as like, you are being casteist, you are raising caste, there is no caste in the society, and you are raising the issue of caste, you are being casteist here. And xenophobia is again that, you know, that you are you are scared of other people and you would like to, you know, kill them or something. So on the issue of xenophobia, and Nilesh Kumar, he writes a very interesting argument. is titled, you know, Stigmatizing Dalits from Women. So these were some quotes which they talk in the this new book, which were unverified. There was no citations, and these are like sweeping comments and to, you know, being presented as facts. So this has been the problem with the distortion part of the introduction. So I'll come back against the madness of Manu, B.R. Ambedkar's writings on Brahminical patriarchy. When asked about the authorship of the book, Sanjeev Chandan, one of the editors of Strikal, he replied saying that, you know, Miss Rege was given this award for her 50-page long introduction to the book, which is a collection of writings by B.R. Ambedkar on Brahminical patriarchy.
Oh, all right, okay. So, Chandrani Chatterjee will be presenting, and then she'll be joined by Vishta Halder, who will join in the question. Well, good evening. This is the last paper of the conference, and thank you for staying back. I'm afraid this is a long paper. I'll read as long as the chair doesn't signal to me, and then I'll stop and we can take questions later.
Yes,
that's fine. So our paper is titled Gendering Dalit Muslim Writing in Bengal. Though there is a Adivasis to politically, aesthetically mark the processes of domination, subjugation and assimilation of these communities in the making of the nation state. Devish Roy, while writing about the socially marginalized, simultaneously dealt with the category Dalit. His initiative of translating and compiling Dalit literature from different Indian languages into Bangla did not include ability. There was, however, the publication of Dalit and Devish Roy's gradual connection with Dalit politics in Bengal made him gravitate to employing the category of caste as the analytical tool rather than class, which he had used before. This marks a diachronic shift in the ideological and political configuration of literary ideals and values in Bangla literature, with the emergence of caste by fracturing the all-encompassing and all-explanatory status of class that remained the master key to understand power and hierarchy in a left-front-oriented political and cultural legacy of a progressive Bengal. We need to be careful about following this legacy of class as an analytical category regarding its dynamics in defining caste and gender oppression while dealing with the Dalit Muslim question in Bangla literature. In our attempt, we are searching for the possibility and also looking at the impossibility of the category. Moments for this new realization of the Dalit Muslim in the history and politics in South Asia are first in the after effect of the Mandal Commission of 1979, and second in the 1992 demolition of the Babri Masjid. The Mandal Commission articulated at the level of constituency and affirmed the presence of the lower caste groups within the Muslim community and brought it, like the lower caste converted populations in Sikh, Buddhist and Christian communities, within the realm of the acute mistrust and aggression between the lower groups of both the Hindu and the Muslim communities, were finally understood as state-induced identity formation of Hindu Dalits unified under the meta-narrative of Hindu fascism and masculinity. In this volatile situation, when the identity of a community is realized in mythological terms, it becomes easy to break free by expressing violence. The moment of violence, in fact, becomes the moment of nomenclature. From this, a radical assertiveness was sought by the lower caste groups in the Muslim community, which not only directed towards a political alliance between the Dalit and the Muslim, but also an identitarian move within the Muslim community. This move was now predicated upon an internal split within the community in the growing realization of an age-old marginalization and exclusion from social and political rights enjoyed by the Muslim elite. This realization culminated in the rise of the Dalit Muslim as a political social identity in the early 1990s in North India, inaugurating the presence of lower caste, making the Ajla fold of the Muslim society and connecting them with the pan-Indian Dalit that shared the same hierarchical structure. Dalit Muslim is not only an identitarian signifier, but a political dynamics pertaining to realization of power play within elite-oriented Muslim politics and right-wing Hindutva ideology. Dalit Muslim as identity is predicated upon the notion of difference within an identity politics explicated in religious terms and moves towards aligning religious identity with caste. Conceptual sameness in the history of exclusion and exploitation became the crux of the new move, a border crossing of caste and religion. On the one hand, it is the reclamation of the continuity between the post-colonial reason and colonial modernity that produced such identifications, while on the other, also a reaffirmation of the colonial national mooring as is valid as pan-Islamic fervor. The emergence of Dalit Muslim politics by default makes the idea of the Muslim community, a monolithic backward group, redundant. By exposing and articulating different interests, inclinations and social processes in terms of caste, it boils down the thrust of Ashrafization within the community as the only marker of social mobility and is targeted towards making a class by aligning the community on the lines of caste. Caste structure in Bengal, in Hitesh Ranjan Shanal's analysis, though was attempted to be understood in terms of interdependence and cooperation, the close association between ritual power and material rank always promoted certain ideas of mobility, which M.N. Srinivas termed as Sanskritization. Richard Eaton explained the presence of such high population of Muslims in the Bengal frontier by denouncing sword and migration theories in favor of social liberalization theory, where economic mobility through the adaptation of the plow and Sufi egalitarianism brought the lower caste or physical professional groups in the folds of Islam since the 13th century. Social mobility and material superiority with the structuring of the community as it was happening in the caste-based Hindu society was predicated upon the thrust and zeal of Ashrafization, realized the Dalit and the subaltern Muslim in close proximity, expressed in economic cooperation, shared cultural artifacts, and also unsentimental competition and coercion over scanty material resources. While Dalit and Dalit Muslim are not identity markers as they have not come up in the identity formation processes like it happened in Maharashtra and Bihar, the Dalit question remains conceptual, not identitarian. These categories should then be understood with respect to the Hinduization of national political movements, the Indian National Congress and the Muslim League, the two players so important in defining the shape and contour of the post-colonial South Asia and practices. The downtrodden, a product of traditional systems of caste, could not have separate demands as the partition created new concept of downtrodden, explicable only in economic terms, though the practice of joint electorate and reservation for the scheduled castes only highlighted the gaps, making class a holistic and transcendental category to solve any discrimination. Religion ritual, by making it invisible as a component of the individual subjectivity and collective identity, was relegated to the realm of the obsolete and the non-viable regressive past. Our authors constantly bear anxiety and show unease about this Marxist socialist ideology that could neither interpret nor engage with the religious spiritual moorings and hierarchy inherent in the Bengali Muslim community. I'll stop here. We had a lot of examples from Bashar and Ahmed, which probably we can take in the Q&A. Thank you.
To whom you want to relate this concept? To the author or those who critiqued? Because in the introduction or in that particular work, she's talking about again the conversation and relation between Gandhi and Ambedkar, and how Gandhi was not worthy of the title Mahatma or saint, etc. So to whom exactly you're relating this idea of
Hello, yeah, it's working, I guess. Yeah, so the upper caste anxiety, that word is that I use in the context of that authenticity issue, where like which the upper caste the ask where you know upper caste can write on that issue. So, but they are actually, they have been writing on this. They have been publishing in journals, research journals, and everywhere they have been, you know, publishing books. Arun Shori's book came much before, I think, on Ambedkar.
So yeah, I think that is the upper caste anxiety which they feel and which all of us that is.
Is it the anxiety of Arundhati Roy or
it is, I think, addressed.
But the introduction is not her work depicting the Dalit life or something. It is that the issue that she's talking about, how the relation between Ambedkar and Gandhi was, and the Kharalanji rape that you mentioned, it also was mentioned because she wanted to, I guess, say how media depicts particular section of society and not the other. It's like she also mentions the Nirbhaya case which happened in Delhi, and she gives a number of like 1200 women, Dalit women, being raped in the same year and not being notified by the media. So I would say, of course, if in case of her book, the small God of Small Things, but this is again, you said that it's a scholarly thing, so the introduction.
See, what I was saying, you know, about the introduction, and what there's one more point that you made, that, you know, if she had published this introduction, which is almost three times of the original book, that would have been banned. So the same publication house, the Navyana, they have published work of The Myth of the Holy Cow. I'm not sure if that is banned. And there are other works of which doesn't even cite the work of Ambedkar. Like, they are not banned, so but you are like the appropriation issue is there, which has been raised, is that, like, why don't publish it like as a standalone book? But she has said that she could have, you know, it's such a long introduction that it could have been a booklet. It's, you know, three times the original book, so it doesn't make sense in that way. And again, there have been many, you know, issues with this introduction, which even Dalit Camera has pointed out in its letter, in its open letter that they wrote to Roy. So I think that's fine. A different issue.
Also, she explores on the classroom lessons also, which used to take place in this university, and the student experience, and that she talks about. So I guess, of course, it is hers.
40-page introduction, 43-page introduction is there. That is by Rege, but the rest of the book is that you can claim that is the book is of Rege. That is the, I think, contestation here.
I have a question come comment for Atul Anand. I think I do feel that there are some legitimate concerns about Arundhati Roy's introduction to Annihilation of Caste. But at the same time, what we must realize is the reason that the introduction is so long is because the book is also meant for a foreign audience, which is oblivious to the problem of caste in India. And we must also appreciate the fact that in bookstores you usually see Gandhi's My Experiments with Truth, Nehru's A Discovery of India, but you never see books by Ambedkar. But due to Arundhati Roy's introduction and the stature that she has in the international market, the visibility of this work has increased to a great extent. So I think that needs to be appreciated. At the same time, yes, the fact that you said about the copyright of Annihilation, if that is true, then that is something that needs to be opposed. So that's what I feel. Thank you.
So kindly to, I feel that you may explain further the Ashrafization. What do you mean by Ashrafization? And so far as my knowledge is concerned, it directly came from the Quran, Ashraful Makhlukat, crown of the creation. So Ashraf itself means crown, not any kind of supremacy. Or whole humankind, whole mankind is Ashraf. So, thank you.
Thank you so much for your question. Yes, you were just right when you talk about the etymological root of Ashraf. But when we talk about Islamization or Islamicate world, then we need to take into consideration the question of Ashraf as an original concept, and Ashrafization as the social process. So if you look at the Islamicate world, at, you know, Hodgson has said in his book, three-volume book, The History of Islam, there he talked about the Islamicate world, where Islam spread from below, not as you know, not through the power of the sword and not through the power of orthodox scriptural religion. So our focus is on Bengal, where there are certain, you know, books of history, especially by Rafiuddin Ahmed and Oshim Roy, who talked about Ashrafization as a major force in the social to understand the configuration and consolidation of the Islamic community, which began in the 13th century, where the spread of Islam and also conversion was a more fluid and spontaneous process, with the help of, not with the manipulation of, but with the egalitarian, you were just right, with the egalitarian language and vocabulary and practice of the Sufis. From there, actually, I wanted to focus on the word Ashrafization. So Ashrafization is actually the process of hegemonization. And when, if you go through the book, The Rise of Islam in the Bengal Frontier by Richard Eaton, you would see that he's actually refuting all the Occidental, Orientalist theories regarding mass conversion. There, he's talking about Ashrafization as a major force which creates a vertical divide within, you know, within an Islamicate world. And it got a kind of climactic force in the mid 19th century with the advent of Islamic reformist movements like Tariqa-e-Muhammadiyya and Ahl-e-Sunnat and Faraizi and Wahhabi in Arab. So there we are looking at, you know, the mass. We are looking at the popular and the heterodox, you know, forms of Islamic practices from the angle of Ashrafization, that there was a kind of very deliberate move towards the creation of the Islamic Islamic community as a consolidated community from mid 19th century onwards. And following those historians, we have used Ashrafization as the name of that process.
Okay, thank you. But simultaneously, if you go through the other books, especially from Abul Hasan Nadwa, and there is, you know, Huntington also wrote The Clash of the Civilization. There is the ex-president of Iran, Khatami, who wrote the rebuttal of this clash to civilization, namely this dialogue among civilizations. So far as the Ashrafization is concerned, it's new to me, because I find, because I almost, you know, visited to the whole India, I don't find any kind of Ashrafization. Yes, I find some kind of, you know, I find some honorable beggars. I call honorable beggars those who are in the shrines, you know, asking for the money, as also in the temples or in churches. So I call them honorable beggars. That is not a Sufi cult. Sufi cult is something different. So they have their own norms. Sufi itself means a sacrificeation of self, communion with the higher, you know, consciousness. The consciousness has its levels. So far as their theories are concerned, not only theories, Sufi itself means the experience. One cannot narrate the, you know, the theory has nothing to do with it, or the books has nothing to do with it. It's an experience, all an experience. So Sufis have no supremacy. Sufis always prevail, you know, equality among the mankind. They came for peace, harmony and love. So far as the Ashrafization is concerned, there are so many writers, especially I came across a book, World Without Islam. Then here, I think the man is David. He mentions about, there would be a no Islam, whether the situation of the Middle East and the whole world is still prevailing like what it is. So these are the questions that should be, you know, addressed. But the Ashrafization, still I have a doubt. So whether there is certainly in Bengal there is some kind of Ashrafization or not.
Excuse me.
So hegemonic, you know, according to you, hegemonic.
I don't want to interrupt, but
get your point. Response. Ashrafization simply means eliticization within the community. So when we talk about the popular ritualistic mass, then according to Francis Robinson, who has worked massively on, you know, Islam in South Asia, he has looked at the dynamics of the community in terms of the, you know, mutual constitutive relationship between the orthodox and the heterodox sects, and no history of any sect, be it Sufism or any kind of other reformist sects or any, you know, sectarian, you know, expression of Islam within, can be understood without looking at the processes of this eliticization or Ashrafization. If you look at Bengal, it's a specific, very curious case. If you look at Bengal, because you find, you know, the massive population within the Muslim fold, coming from the lower professional strata of the society. So it's 13th century onwards till date. It's a kind of shifting from below. It's a kind of creation of the community from below. One, with the help of the Sufi philosophers, which were true, that they talked and they have been talking in the language of egalitarianism and equality. And also, here I should make an alert that Sufism is not only, you know, a monolithic version of egalitarianism and equality, because the thrust of mid-19th century Islamic reform also fell upon the Sufi, you know, sects. And what we see, the Chishtiyas are completely different from the Qadiriyas and the Naqshbandiyas, and also Suravardiyas. So their connection with the...
I think, perhaps...
Navena publication actually tried to tax on Arundhati Roy's popularity in the Western academia or in the Western world to sell the book in the Western academia. So I wouldn't say that it is something that can be appreciated, because, I mean, the fact... I'm not valorizing Ambedkar in that essentialist fashion and saying that Ambedkar does not need an introduction, but this kind of an attempt. So when you have Dalit studies, when you have Dalit movement, when you have all kinds of questions regarding representation and patronizing and all kinds of such arguments in Indian academia, when a so-called informed publisher like Navayana taking a step like this and making Arundhati Roy to introduce Ambedkar, or maybe not any other Dalit academician or Dalit activist. So, because when you read Arundhati Roy, you also get this disclaimer from Arundhati Roy that, you know, she probably cannot do something of this sort, you know, introduce Ambedkar. And again, if you look at Arundhati Roy, you also see that till Annihilation of Kashi has been a literary writer plus a political critique and analyst of Indian democracy and, say, Naxal movement and anti-Naxal movement, Operation Greenhand, and all kinds of such things. So bringing in someone of that sort to introduce Ambedkar is in some way very problematic. So that should be the way in which probably we should look at it. Thank you.
Hello, here. Hello.
Okay. So I think this will probably be our last question.
Yeah. This question pops up in my mind whenever I come across the tag Dalit literature. I mean, are we not making a way for a different sort of caste biasness when it comes to a Dalit literature with reference to a Marathi novelty?
If it was yesterday or 2 days ago, but it's only one, you know, one more step. So we have a few more things that we want to say about the publications that are that have already been lined up and that are still being, you know, thought about. So Nicole, would you like to say things?
Yes. Yeah. Also, quickly, would like to thank you for staying. I know we have packed this schedule very densely because there are so many people who had something to say, and look, I mean, you're still there, and even the people who didn't present still have so much to say, so I mean, this is quite wonderful, so thank you for that. There are a few publications that will come out of the network events, and I mean, since we're already looking ahead, I think even though with Delhi, the series of AHRC-funded events will come to a close. Ultimately, I think the network as such will, in all likelihood, continue, because I think there seems to be a great demand in order to discuss these topics in an interdisciplinary and forum that is both situated within and outside of academia. And I think the first publication that is sort of in the process of coming out of this network, of these network events, reflects this already. You know, we have a journal issue in the Journal of Commonwealth Literature coming out. I mean, it was accepted. The papers are still now being finalized. They will be submitted very soon, and then we'll have to go through the various peer review stages. But so this is going to be an issue that is reflects that includes interviews, writers, translators, you know, JN. So already it's an unusual publication, I think, that is quite befitting to a fairly wide and open network that we were trying to create with you. And I think the next publication to which you, you know, the presenters, who is a publication, an edit collection by Orion Black Swan, and I don't know, Judith, whether you want to say something, because you're the one.
So in fact, we have decided to, since we have been working in a very collegial, you know, and collective fashion, so we always do everything together, make all the decisions together, but sometimes, you know, one of us will take up or such thing, and then another one can concentrate, you know, more time and more energy on another thing. So Nicole has been more upfront, I mean, front stage for the JCL special issue, and I will probably be a bit more front stage for the. In fact, the contacts have already been made, and the Routledge volume that you have heard about and that you have seen flyers for outside had originally been accepted both by Routledge and Orion Black Swan. And so we had to choose, because Orion Black Swan was wanting us to pass from 400 pages to 300 pages. And after having worked 2 years with you know, 21 contributors, I couldn't decently ask the contributors to go back to the articles and reduce them in length. So this is one of the reasons why we went for Routledge. But the contacts, in fact, were made, and so Orion Black Swan has said that yes, they would be interested in collaborating with us for another publication. So it would be an edited collection, and in the same way as the JCL issue will be co-edited by Satyanarayana, Nicole, and myself, the Orion Black Swan edited collection will be co-edited by the same three co-editors. So, to come back to one of the issues that was mentioned, the book will be, yes, co-edited by three people who will be taking responsibility for all the articles that will be included in the book. But of course, the voice of each contributor is their own voice. Okay? So this is already, you know, underway, and so we're looking into, 2016. So I will be sending a collective message because there is a very precise style sheet as well that will have to be abided by, and so people who want to contribute will have to, you know, follow in a very strict way, I mean, the style sheet that will be sent. And so there will be deadlines, and so again, I mean, deadlines have to be, you know, abided by. And so it's part of the process, and if we want the publications to be released in a timely fashion, we have to abide by those deadlines. You know, so the JTL special issue has taken more time than it was originally planned, and this is not good. This is not good for the network. So it is good in a way because it has allowed us to put together something that I'm sure would be extremely interesting. Again, it's oriented towards the market outside of India. So in order to bring more people, you know, to be able to read Dalit literatures, about Dalit literatures, and in translation as well. So it has its own challenges. The Orion Black Swan edited collection will be much more, you know, turned towards the South Asian market, even though there will also be distribution outside of India, hopefully, but it's mostly a South Asian market, and it will be a much more specialized audience as well, and much more specialized readers. So whether we go for, you know, whether the contributors go for the JCL special issue or the Orion Black Swan special issue, it will not be the same articles, it will not be crafted in the same way as well, and it will not be the same readers. So this is important to bear in mind, because if you have something that is too low-key, too open, too general for the Orion Black Swan, it will be rejected. If you have something too specialized, too specific for the, you know, JCL or another publication, it will be rejected. You know, so we have to target things. I mean, this is, well, our job as well as editors, but it's, I think it's essential in order to be able to be accepted and then make a way, you know, into the different markets. So sorry about this, you know, strong insistence on markets, but it is also part of the game, and we want the work out there. Okay, so this is the aim. And there is another publication you want to mention?
Well, there is one more publication that is a little bit my baby. I would like to produce a book that would be geared towards more of an undergraduate but also postgraduate audience, because as a teacher of Dalit literature in a UK university, the challenges I think are quite different to the ones that people teaching Dalit literature face in India, where people know about caste and know, you know, basic facts about regional history. So this is going to be, so if you might want to be interested in that, it would be, if these would have to be contributions that are in a way much more generalized, geared, as I said, towards an audience that will know very little, but nevertheless you need to include information that will also be interesting for, say, a postgraduate level. So I mean, these are, as I said, these publications are kind of directed at very, very specific audiences, but I think that they all have their own merit. And can I just say something about the next conference? Because I thought it was so interesting that in Atul's paper, you know, sparked such a heated debate. And in some ways that paper would have almost sat better in the Delhi conference that is going to start in 2 days. And I think a few of the people who will have presented here will present there, and I know a few people who haven't presented here will nevertheless migrate with us to Delhi to attend this event. So this is going to be, even though this is going to be the last funded event so far, we are working on other funding applications. So if you have any ideas, you are always very welcome to get in touch with us. We are, you know, just the conveners of this network. Ultimately, everyone who's interested in being part of the network is part of the network. And so far, the most maybe somewhat clunky and not terribly maybe technologically advanced way of communicating with the network is an email subscription list audience. And we must thank, of course, the organizers here. I think Aniket and Chandrani have been just wonderful, and we all wish Aniket a very, very speedy recovery. We're sorry that we have tired him out and too much. And the student helpers have been also really marvelous. The sound people, thank you. We couldn't have done this without you. So thank you very much, and thank you, Judith.
Thank you, Nicole.
Okay, thank you.